You ready? Here we go. Yay! Everybody! Woo! What I want to say was yesterday that I saw you on so clear.
If you see the old photographs, they do look, you know, like their original boy band.
I think the best thing we did was like falling off a horse and getting back up again. That's what we did.
I personally think they are the most important group, you know, that we've had.
Let's see everybody. The Miami are just the greatest.
Clap your hands. Woo! Stop your feet.
Anybody know what this song is?
No.
No? Simple Simon Says. We want you all to join along. Are you ready? Here we go. Everybody, let's see ya. Okay.
I'd like to play a game that's so much fun, not so very hard to do.
Great to be back working with a band again, a full band.
I'd like for you to play it too.
On this tour, like, you know, we've had a lot of fun, you know, both on stage and off, yeah.
A bit like the Twilight Zone, I feel like I never left.
The crack as good as it was back in the young days. It's great fun. I honestly think that comes across on stage as well. You have a good laugh, eat, sleep, drink, be merry, and it's just like kids all over again.
If you were to choose anybody that you'd say would play the theme tune for the 60s and 70s of Ireland as a developing nation, it would be the Showbands, because they reflected and sometimes even led pop culture.
Okay, you know the words. Here we go. Everybody clap your hands. Come on, let's see it. Woo! You're my lady.
The 60s, certainly up until 69, 70, were dominated by show bands, and it was very much a social phenomenon as well. Like.
Warm as sunshine, lips that taste
the sweet. The ballrooms all over the country as well as the cities, you know. So they were great places for, you know, for people to get together, to dance, to meet one another, you know. So I think they were very important, yeah.
The show bands were absolutely unbelievable in their day. We're looking back at the late 60s, 70s. If you want to talk about how big the bands were, the Miami were actually known as the Irish Beatles. So, you know, that was quite an honour to be called that in our day.
I mean, it's well documented that at one time there was over 600 bands on the road. Now, all those bands had to be fed, they had to be clothed, their vehicles had to be looked after, petrol. It was a whole massive industry surrounding.
Show bands, they meant an awful lot to people way back in the 60s and the 50s and 60s, because it actually started in my town. The show bands started in Strabane with a band called the Clipper Carton, and then the Melody Aces were there as well. Lots of good bands came from the Northwest, because the Northwest have they've been blessed with great musicians and some fine singers up there as well. So they sort of led the way, and then there were so many great bands coming out of Belfast and out of the rest of Northern Ireland, and then right down to Southern Ireland. But the Clipper sort of led the way there. So they meant a big lot to people like myself, and we grew up through show business. I was a big, big follower of Joe Dolan. I followed him all the time, and I used to go to all the different dances in Donegal and in the Palindrome in Strabane. It meant an awful lot to young people like myself at the time, growing up, and it was a way of people getting to meet maybe their new partners or their wives-to-be or their husbands-to-be. So it meant an awful lot for people in the 60s and 70s.
You know, it was a developing country, and the young people were finding their feet and becoming more confident, today they're as confident as anybody, but that didn't come out of thin air. So from being a rural country to what we have today, the bands reflect, and if you look at the history of the bands and the way that the bands themselves developed from playing covers to then eventually having the confidence to do their own material, I think the bands, show bands, the history of show bands, the history of Irish popular music would be a good parallel to the development of the country.
Well, I could just sit around making music all day long. The band, if you look back at our photographs of the band in years gone by, and you look at the band, there's a lot of similarities with bands like Westlife and things like that today, with the suits, the image, the hair, everything. It's, I think Louis Walsh, you see, used to be our manager, so I think he's learnt a few things from us over the years.
Miami are just the greatest.
I believe in music.
So I have that for me. I started going to see them when I was only 15. My grandmother had got tickets to go to Gallagher's concert. Her and her friend were going, and there was an extra ticket. So I was allowed to go with them. And from the minute the Miami come on stage, it was the first live show that I'd ever seen. And just from the minute they come on stage, I was hooked. Lift your
voices to the sky. God, did you fall in love with that night?
Oh, definitely, Dickie.
Yeah.
Dickie Rock.
I believe in music. I believe in love. Sing to me, children.
Well, the original Miami, I remember with Dickie Rock, of course, and they were a great band, and I have to say, I admire Dickie, and still do today, a great singer.
Now, that wasn't the first Miami. There was a guy called Jimmy Hart, was the lead singer with the Miami. But the Miami that I fell in love with was Dickie Rock and Miami. And it was on the 23rd of September, 1965.
Fernand O'Toole and that Miami, they were one of the highlights, the lights of that were still around at that time. And they were building up pop, and they were doing a lot of their own material, and I admired them for that as well.
So then Fran came along.
Well, they came along in 67. No matter where they were, I was on the road, and my family didn't know this, but most of the time I was thumb the lift. And we went all over Ireland. Now, I didn't go on my own. My sister went with me, or there was other friends went. And we would have left Gallagher's at 1 o'clock on a Friday. And we would have been in Tralee at 10 o'clock at night for the dance. Or there was one night we thumbed the lift to Cork. And we get into Cork at 10 to 2 in the morning, and the dance was over at 2 o'clock. And we had to start and get home again to go to Caproni's on a Saturday night. I don't want to see that.
I don't want to see this one, because I know in this photograph, there's somebody that we all know in this photograph, and that's you there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Wow.
That was taken in the Floral Hall. These four girls were from the Falls Road. Mm-hmm. And I would have met up with them and set the dances. And these two girls I worked with. And Maureen, you can't really see her. We got good friends with Maureen. I ended up going away on holidays with Maureen and getting the sack out of Gallagher's. So I did, because I had been away for a fortnight.
Right.
And then the Miami were playing somewhere for 3 days, and I wanted to be there, and they wouldn't give me another 3 days off. So I sent in a sick line and came back from the 3 days to find out I'd got the sack.
Lynn, she's an incredible lady. You know, she could tell any of the band who sang what song, who sang harmonies. So-and-so used to date this girl and married this one. She's an incredible memory. And if we are rehearsing close to Belfast, she'll turn up with sandwiches and soup and coffee. And she's a beautiful woman, really lovely, lovely lady. And she's on the phone every day to Dickie Rock. You know, so her and Dickie are very, very good friends. You know, so like I say to the guys, if you only had another 1,000 like her, you know, she is an absolute one-off.
Do you have any idea how many times you've seen the Miami play over the years?
No.
No?
Couldn't even start to count.
Hundreds, wouldn't it?
Yeah, definitely. This is the five new fellas that joined
okay. In
1967. Fran, Pat, Brian, Paul and Dez.
Look at this, sir. The big dimple.
Thinking back to the start, how did you actually join the Miami Showband? Was it like an audition process? Was there an advert placed in a newspaper? How did the band actually come together?
I was playing away in a band in Cork. My sister actually got a phone call in Belfast to say that the Miami were looking for me, but she told the Miami, I don't think Des would be interested because he's doing very well in Cork. And he's got his girlfriend in Cork as well, so I don't think he'd be interested in going. Well, I nearly shoved the phone around my sister's neck. I was not impressed that she'd said that. And immediately I got on to who was then the manager of the Miami, was Tom Doherty. And I'll never forget it, because Tom was actually out at church at the time. And I left a message with his family that if he could please phone me when he came back, and he did, he phoned me. He said to me, Des, unfortunately the job is gone, and I couldn't believe it. But he said, I'll tell you what I'll do, I'll give you a call on Monday morning. And they had actually already selected a saxophonist vocalist. And I got a call on that Monday afternoon to say, come up and see us in Dublin, you've got the job. And I was so excited.
I had a brother who run a famous dance in Anton called the Deer Park for years. And I had played actually with a relief band there at times, but my main job at that time was playing with Liam McCafferty and the Glens Men. And when I stopped playing with them, I went to Canada for a year, and I heard that the Miami job was up for grabs. And the management had actually heard me playing before the Miami in the Deer Park with the relief band, so I come home and auditioned for the job, and I got it. That was in 73.
1975, I got a call to know if I'd be interested in playing with the band, and I was always with the beat groups, rock groups you call them today. I don't really think I would have been interested if it were a regular show band at the time, but the Miami had evolved into a pop band, a pop group, and I was attracted by the fact that this was a band that was writing its own material. Fran and Des were already recognized songwriters. It was an attractive fan to join. Obviously then you got a steady wage as well, which was a big plus.
More than the minister's estate?
£3,000 a year.
Come on! Dance, dance, dance! Dance, dance, dance!
Let's talk about Fran. What type of a person was Fran?
Oh, the nicest. He was... Nobody could have said a word against Fran.
He wasn't at all like your typical pop star, you know.
Fran was, I suppose, an icon of that era.
Everybody loved him. Love is warm, love is free, love is deep inside me.
Heaven knows how it grows with every new... I remember Phil Lynott once told me that he reckoned that Fran was the greatest soul singer that Ireland ever produced. I certainly wouldn't doubt that. He was a massive talent. Now I see love for the first
time. He was the quintessential pop star, and there was a group out at that time called Small Faces, which are huge, and Fran would have fitted it. Just, you could take him out and put him into that. He had that lovely baby face.
I don't know, he was funny.
He was a bit like a kid, a very, very funny, very innocent type person. And yet when he became this other person when he went on stage. And that I have no doubt. All I can say to you won't change things now. What's been done, been done. There's been a change in me.
And Paul and him were a double act. Paul and him always went about together. And I remember the first time I was talking to Paul. Paul says to me, do you know Lenny's a gas man? And I thought, gas man? I wonder, is he one of these wee men that walk about emptying the people's meters and leaving them their change in that? And he says, no, I don't think so. He says, gas means funny.
All right.
But I didn't know what a gas man was. All I can say to you won't change things now.
Every mother wanted Fran for a son-in-law. He had that little baby face, you know, and that cheeky little grin. And every girl would have loved to brought Fran home to the mother, you know, and every mother would have loved Fran.
You know, if you think back, you had the Bay City Rollers and you had the Osmonds. Well, the closest Ireland came to anything like that was Fran.
So let the truth set you free. Now that it's over for me. Now that it's over for me.
Bran McCoy, you know, was just the most ethical, trustworthy, straight guy I have ever met in my life.
Look at Brian there.
I used to do the money and pay expenses and things. If there was 2p difference, Brian would have given it. He was just so, so straight, so, so ethical, so, so honest.
And this is the record that he had made in 74. There won't be any more.
There won't be any more. There won't be any more.
That was a letter from Brian when they lived on the North Circular Road. And it just says, Lynn, thank you very much for your letter. I do hope you enjoyed the dance on Friday night in Banbridge. We did a recording for the 17 Club on Radio Ireland last night, so you'll be able to hear it on Sunday at 7:15. We're off this week, so I'm really looking forward to the rest. Maybe we'll go away for a few days, so until I see you at the weekend, take care. Love, Brian.
And Tony, quiet. His own sense of mischievous humour, Dubliner to the core, and as they all were, fantastic player.
At that time, Tony had come from a band called Adolf J. Rag, and he would have been on a par, say, with somebody like Gary Moore, people like that.
There just won't be any more.
If you look across the road here now, you're going to see Lucky's Bingo Club. That was originally the Castle Ballroom. And basically, any night we arrived to play here, we'd go up that entry just there. Around the back, there's a car park area. And from there, our musical equipment would have come in with our road manager at the time, Bran McGuire. We would normally arrive after Bran would have set up all the gear, arrive to do the show. The show that night was a great night. It was very busy and... I remember that after the show, what we normally always do, we go and have a cup of tea, and everybody was in great spirits. Just another night on the road, everybody having fun. And then as soon as the show would be over, normally what would happen is Brian McGuire would be after us because he would have to pack the gear and all that sort of thing. But it was a strange thing on that particular night. We actually were behind Brian. Brian had gone ahead of us heading towards Dublin. And on that particular night, he had actually taken a couple of girls who had wanted a lift back into Newry. And thank God, we didn't take anybody down that night with us as we were driving back to Newry. And that's my memories of leaving this particular venue, probably to run about, I would say. Well, the gig was finished normally around 1:30, 2 o'clock probably. We were on the road from here, heading down towards, going back to Dublin, actually. Ray lived in Antrim, so Ray came down in his own car and he drove back after the gig. He went straight back to Antrim. So in the band, it was just the five other guys of the band. Myself, Stephen Travers, Bran McCoy, God rest him, Tony Garrity, God rest him, and Fran O'Toole, God rest him. There was another series of gigs after that. So we would have been playing probably for 3 or 4 nights after that as well. That was the plan, you know. It's just like every other week, you know, you were quite used to all the roadblocks and things like that that happened at that particular time. You would be stopped, the van would be searched and things like that, so that was quite a common occurrence. So as we were heading down towards Newry first, obviously, and then on to Dublin, we were stopped at a roadblock, what we thought was a normal roadblock. Everything looked to be in order. And that's when we were pulled over and we were asked to get out of the vehicle. Basically, we were asked all sorts of questions. I'll never forget one of the questions we were actually asked was, which one of you is Dickie Rock? And Dickie had actually left the band at that stage. Dickie had formed his own band. Yeah. And the lead singer in the band at that time was Fran O'Toole. So as I say, we got stopped. It was a pretty normal stop. All sorts of questions asked, names, addresses, where we were going to, where we were coming from. And then I asked, could I take my saxophone out and put my saxophone on the side of the road? So I moved from where I was in the line, and I went to the vehicle to take my saxophone out and put it down on the side of the van. And so instead of going back to where I was in the line, I stayed at the very end next to the actual minibus, and questions continued, and the guys were going to the van. We just, nobody thought of anything happening. It was just a normal standard thing, and the next thing before we knew it, all hell broke loose, because what actually happened was that there was an explosion, and that blew me over the ditch into the field. And the next thing, there was just all mayhem, everything, all hell broke loose. There was gunfire, screaming, shouting, running. It was just a terrible, terrible situation. And this is exactly the spot. Yeah. That's it.
Yeah. There's a roundabout here that we would have been stopped. The van probably would have been somewhere there. And there was vehicles here, I remember, behind us here. And that was the field there that I was blown into. And the ditch along here. And basically what happened at the time with the impact of the actual, the bomb exploding, it actually set the ditch on fire. And what happened, the ditch was on fire, but as the ditch was on fire, it was coming towards me, and I made a run up here onto this main road. And when I got up here, there was vehicles got up and down the road on both sides. The vehicles stopped, and then there was a truck that came along with a large articulated truck. It had a big section on the back of it, and I asked the guy, would he give me a lift down to Newry Police Station? And he refused to take me. I even said to him, I'll get on the back where the trailer section is, and I'll sit there. And he said, no, he wouldn't take me. So he obviously probably thought maybe that I was part of the whole whatever had happened. And then a young couple came along in their car, and they actually took me down to Newry Police Station to actually report the incident, which I did. And I left, when I left this particular scene, it was a scene of absolute carnage and devastation. I stayed most of the night in the police station for they asked about drawing identikits, and they were questioning me about the event. And of course I panicked, I was screaming and shouting for them to get somebody out here as quickly as possible. But what they actually said to me was they couldn't do that because they'd be afraid that they would be attacked, whoever would come out. So they had to get helicopters to come out and floodlights the whole area to find out exactly what was going on. So I wasn't aware myself at that particular time about exactly what had happened. From my point of view, the only pain I had was in my leg. It was shrapnel from probably the van exploding. But what I cannot understand to this day, it's something which I'll never understand, is that I was that close to the actual van. The van exploded and I survived. I'll never understand why how I could survive that. Thank the Lord I'm here today. But it's very sad that Brian, Fran and Tony aren't. So this is quite a cold spot. We stop here quite often, going between Belfast and Dublin, etc. And
Stephen and I come here together sometimes, and sometimes we come on our own, come here and always say a prayer. I hope in my lifetime, I would love to see a monument here, or a plaque or whatever, in memory of Fran, Bran and Tony. Hopefully.
It was absolutely horrific what happened, you know. I think it took a long time to, you know, for the whole Irish music industry, like, really to get over that, you know, like, when it did happen.
We had a drummer at that time called Martin Brannigan, who was in the Miami with Fran O'Toole and the boys. He was playing resident in Barry's Hotel in Dublin with Keegan, I think Peter Keegan. So Martin called us all and told us. A state of shock, really.
Absolute total waste of life. And it's literally going to change what I would call the showband entertainment scene forever, which it didn't. But for a long, long time, bands just, you know, said, well, that, you know, that's too horrific to contemplate being caught up in it. And
I couldn't cope. I went to bed for months, just didn't want to know nobody.
Horrific, you know. I mean, now I still can't come down that road and not think about it, you know, and no reason that I've to think that anything's wrong, but I don't like traveling that stretch of road now after about 10 o'clock at night, and that's 75, and we're now 2009, so what's that, 34 years? Still don't like traveling that stretch of road, you know, so, but that'll always be with me.
It's hard to believe that that bus shelter's here. Still after 30 odd years, bus shelter's still there. I don't know. Maybe Linnet's here for a reason. Yeah.
I know I've come down and put flowers down, but they never lasted.
Yeah.
They were away, yeah. And I had to put them down on the way to Dublin, and they'd have been away when I was coming back from Dublin.
Yeah.
For whatever reason.
The one thing about actually having the actual shelter here is that it's, we always know where the exact spot of the tragedy took place, and we tell our friends as well that if they're looking for the spot, to look for the bus shelter, and that would be it. But yeah, it's quite amazing after all these years. That was the main road originally to Belfast. Quite a cold spot, this, I can tell you. Yeah, it's cold. Like I say, I just hope and pray one day, I really would, and I'm sure Lynn feels the same, and anybody who was involved with the guys and knew how nice they all were, one day we'd love to see their memory kept alive in this particular spot. And as I said earlier, I hope it happens in my lifetime. Please God. You can never forget that night. You'll never forget that terrible tragedy. And also, on our shows now, we're using a lot of video slide projection of our actual, the band down through the years. So it's, yeah, it's heart-wrenching to look around and see some of those photographs. Memories come back of the good times, et cetera, and to see, you know, Fran, who was an extremely good-looking guy, and Brian and Tony, and it's quite amazing that you turn around, you look at those photographs, and they're no longer here. And yeah, it's painful at times.
Banbridge is the last place that we were happy on stage, so we're sort of completing a circle there.
Well, as we go around the country, every venue we're going to, where people are bringing old photographs that we'd signed for us to have a look at. They're bringing records. They're coming up and chatting about the various venues that they used to go to watch the band. So it's quite a lot of nostalgia involved in this tour, which is quite exciting.
I want to remember the guys who had been happy on stage and everybody in happy. I was really proud to be playing with them, you know, so that would have been one of the nights that that was important to me as were the other nights. So in a way, you should have gone back and almost thanking people in Banbridge for giving you that type of memory. The best thing we did was like falling off a horse and getting back up again. That's what we did, you know. And I'm really proud the other two guys, Des and Ray, did the same thing. You know, we just got it together and got back there.
Very nice to see the boys back on stage again, and you know there's a lot of bad memories there, but thank God they're out and they're playing for everyone, and everyone's enjoying it. So, you know, it's nice that they're there again.
Barry, I've been to the toilet. Yeah, Stephen, toilet. Thank you. Okay. You've been to the toilet.
Yes.
Johnny Fien, been to the toilet.
Right, before we go any further, I'd like to introduce you to the band. To a guy who claims to be the youngest member of the band at 75. And the funny thing is, we've never actually seen his birth certificate. Ladies and gentlemen, over here on keyboards and vocals, Mr. Jerry Brown.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'd just like to point out, I never lie about my age. I don't tell lies. Ask my brother Elvis.
When I was 18, 19, I did backing vocals in London for Cliff Richard and Dana. And I did the backing vocals on a program called Minder. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
I could be so good for you. So like every little tiny thing that you do, it just leads you in this path, you know. So once you get to what I regard as the greatest of all the Irish bands, you know, you're sort of well aware that you are going into this strange legend, but everything that you've done in the past has just led you to that point.
Over here on saxophone, keyboards, vocals, and whiskey, ladies and brandy, is it brandy? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Barry Woods.
With open arms, I was welcomed. With open arms. I knew Ray, and I actually knew, I played in show bands years and years ago. And I used to bump regularly into Fran O'Toole. So we were always kind of like shifts in the night.
Right, we are honoured and privileged to be playing with this man because he played with one of the best groups ever to come out of Ireland, Horselips, of course, on lead guitar and vocals, Johnny Fien.
Steve and myself have been good friends for many years. We both lived in London. We started playing together, and we've more or less been playing together ever since. And when Steve came up with the idea to form the Miami Showband, he asked if he'd like to go on tour with the band, and I thought it would be a nice thing to do, actually, you know, to play with the band. So that's how it came about. Everything's gonna be all right, so be my guest tonight. Gonna dance to the rock and roll, gonna even do the show. Gonna Lindy Hop and Susie Q, join the party just for you. So fine, don't let me down.
back here on the drums from a place called Antrim is Mr. Ray Miller. Okay, over here on bass guitar and vocals, ladies and gentlemen, Stephen Travers.
Okay, folks, in the middle, singer-songwriter, sex symbol extraordinaire, Mr. Desley.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Tour, like, you know, we've been having a lot of fun, you know, both on stage and off, yeah.
Look at me, he's a jockstrap.
The crack is as good as it was back in the young days.
I think you're fired. You're no good.
It's great fun. I honestly think that comes across on stage as well. You put your hand in your head, but now you let your backbone. Your hand in the air, you make a peace sign, you just don't care. When I free, free, gonna lose control. All God's children got some soul. You don't have to think, you don't move a muscle. Do the brow beating, let the heavy resurrection
show. He hangs all his stuff up on the floor.
I know. I'm Felix Unger.
Felix Unger, yeah.
I go in the bathroom every morning, right? It's got his hair stuff, his moisturising cream every morning, same ritual, moisturising cream, face.
That's arms. Not true, I do not.
Yes, you
I'm,
do.
I'm an athlete.
Yes, you do. You're a big tart. Right? He does that.
The band's watching their weight.
We're not allowed to eat those.
They're just for show.
No, they are. We're fully paid up members of Weight Watchers.
Yep.
And I'm watching his weight. And he's watching mine.
Everybody, let's see. Everybody. Now here's the Dancy Show.
Gorgeous lady just went past there.
I saw him.
We got love, we both share. We go together everywhere. Love's in me, love's in you, just the way I want. Everybody! So let's hold on to love, let it last forever. Yeah, let's hold.
It was fantastic. I really enjoyed it.
Great.
Yeah.
It's terrific.
It's absolutely wonderful. We got so much to share.
Are you a big fan of Miami right from
the
start?
Yes, from the very start. I'm not telling you many years ago, like, but yes, I went in quite often.
Uh-huh. His girl's mum was another cousin of Brian's.
Uh-huh.
So,
thanks very much for coming along.
It was great.
Lovely
to see you.
Thank you
very much. Nice to meet you.
Okay. This girl, by the way, has followed me
for
about 25 years.
Really?
I used to dance to them years ago in the Adelphi and in Ballymascanlon.
Wow.
Wonderful. Yes, I did. Yeah. Yes, I did. I'm old enough to be the same brand. Yeah.
Hold on to love. So let's hold on. Hold on to love. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And looking at the tour so far, I think we're all quite amazed, every one of us, at how successful it's been. And not only that, the reaction that we're getting off the audience is as good today as it was in those days in the early 70s. So it's quite phenomenal, actually.
But so far, the crowds have been fantastic, you know. And I have people coming up to me saying, I remember we danced to the Miami in Cork and met my wife there, you know. So the memories are there for people.
We hope, number one, that this tour will prove that the band has still a lot to offer. I mean, people who come, I suppose the rest of the boys have told you, the last four or five concerts have been absolutely terrific. Great audience reaction. You know, and I do keep saying, if the band is enjoying it, the audience will.
We got a very, very special guest here tonight, been a good friend of ours for many, many years. It happens to be Jerry's sister. Do you know who she is? All kinds of everything. That's her. She's Dana, where are you, my darling? Come and join us. There you are, my darling. That's for you. This is one. Oh, do you like that?
Love this, the one you're with.
Love the one you're with, baby. Okay, this is one we sang in the Opera House, wasn't it, in Belfast?
We did, yeah. Indeed, yes.
We did this. This is a song that was written by myself and Fran O'Toole. This went on to be number one. This is a song, gorgeous song called Love Is.
Oh,
okay.
Thank God for that.
Woo! All right. Ooh. Smile on sunshine, smile on. I can see it in your eyes. All your love you give to me, only me.
Somehow I was all alone, thinking life had passed me by. Then I saw your smiling face, smiling face.
Love is warm, love is free, love is deep inside me. Heaven knows how it grows with every new day. Love is burning, love is turning, making changes in my life. A brand new me. I see love for the first time. Shout on
with the reaction that we are getting, like Bellamy and Armagh and Cork and all the rest, everybody that we've played for so far, they all want us back. So we wouldn't like to be doing it every week, but certainly we'll tour again next year.
Love is war. Love is deep inside of me.
We have kind of spoken about maybe getting together to do a few songs, or that would be, you know, that would be kind of further down the line. Making changes in my life, a brand new me. Now I see love for the
first time. Have you heard? We're hoping we'll take off a little bit outside of Ireland as well as in Ireland, kind of thing, you know. So hopefully, like, the band will be pretty busy in 2009. That's the hope. Anyway. So many times before, and it's knocking on my door for me and you.
Love is warm, love is free, love is deep inside of me. Heaven knows how it grows with every new day. Love is warm, love is free, love is deep inside of me. Heaven knows how it grows with every new day. Love is warm. Thank you.
Thank
Ladies
you.
And gentlemen, Dana.
The Miami!
It's just a case of the band playing, you know, and we've all talked about it, you know, and they're still eager to do it. And, you know, it's an awful shame that a band with that pedigree, you know, isn't working.
We have our own thing, we have our own sound. The band is established, it's known all over the world. When you see your posters being sold on eBay, you think, you know, somebody must think something of it. You're the only girl that I want to be near. I wish I had a crystal ball, but though I need to see, you need me. And then we had six ways. Let's see everybody.
Clap your hands. It was great to see them back on stage. It was great to hear that sound of brass, because brass has gone from bands nowadays. It's all electronics, it's all backing tracks. So to hear musicians playing and the quality of the musicians shown tonight, and after 30 odd years, it's great to see the lads back on the stage again together. It's, for me, very nostalgic and very emotional.
Okay, let's see you all sing. Here we go.
It's such a legendary name, you know, and it should be performing. You know, whether it's us in another 10 or 15 years, who knows? Like, it'll probably be me somewhere, because I'll be only 40 then. But the rest will be pension age.
It's for us now. It's for us and the people, and it's not about anything other than enjoying ourselves. And there are lots and lots of guys who would have been playing our contemporaries who don't have the opportunity, don't have the chance to do this now. And so we don't take it for granted anymore. I think we did at one stage, you know, we thought it was perhaps our God-given right, because we were, sometimes you get above your station, but now we go back really happy and grateful that we're up there playing, all of us.
Everybody, let's see you sing.
We intend to continue, because it's been such a buzz of late. It would be a shame to see it, you know, slip away. So while it's there, the people want us, and as long as the audiences want you, then I think it's right to continue. Makes me feel young.
Okay, here we go. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, I brushed down my shoes.
forgot my workday blues and headed off into the night.
Mellowing in our old age, I would say we're getting worse, to be honest with you. If that's possible.
Who gets the most female attention?
At the moment, without a doubt, mate.
But Dez is a ladies' man.
There's a certain member of the band that thinks that he gets more attention than me, and his name would probably be Jerry Brown.
Was it kind of sex, drugs, and rock and roll?
I don't know what book you've been reading, but it wasn't the one I was in, I can assure you, you know.
One night I had a terrible accident. I arrived, I thought it was 12 o'clock dancing, it was half 11. And it was a marquee, and the stage was a 40-foot trailer, and the drums were set up and all, and I jumped up onto the stage, and I went one, two, and the seat was too close, and I went to move it, and I fell off the back of the 40-foot trailer, and the band started without me. So that's typical of my days in the Miami. There was never a dull moment.